Considered one of the finest in the world, the Art Institute's collection of European paintings contains more than 3,500 works dating from the 12th through the mid-20th century. Their collection of Impressionist and Post-impressionist art is one of the largest in the world. We'll start there. Late 19th century France, the birthplace of Impressionism. The name most commonly associated with Impressionism is Monet, as the term itself is derived from the title of one of his paintings, Impression Sunrise. Claude Monet's father wanted him to go into the family grocery business, but Monet wanted to be an artist. His mentor Eugène Boudin instilled in him a taste for painting outdoors, so much so that when he traveled to Paris to visit the Louvre, he noticed how other painters would copy from the old masters. Monet preferred to sit by a window, look outside, and copy from the master painter himself. He once said, "Everyone discusses my art and pretends to understand, as if it were necessary to understand, when it is simply necessary to love." The Art Institute has its fair share of post-impressionist works as well, such as those by Henri de Toulouse-Lautrec. Because of injuries that left his legs crippled, he was at full height, barely 5 feet tall. But his misfortune was a blessing in disguise. Since he could no longer follow his father in the pastimes of riding and hunting, he instead focused on art, and later, the bohemian life. He frequented the famous Parisian nightclub Le Moulin Rouge, seen in this work, in which he depicted many of his friends and favorite entertainers. One option available for your listening pleasure is the audio guide, which features commentary on many of the works on display. If you're visually impaired, it won't cost you a thing. But if your faculty of sight is fully functional, be prepared to pay $7. In 1891, Paul Gauguin sailed from France to the Polynesian tropics to escape, quote, "everything that is artificial and conventional." The paintings from this final period of his life of the inhabitants of Tahiti and the Marquesas Islands are the heart of the Art Institute's Gauguin collection. Gauguin is also remembered for his friendship and rivalry with Vincent van Gogh. Few painters like van Gogh have expressed themselves with such intensity and passion. A profoundly sensitive and artistic person, the tragedy of his life was his inability to adjust and his persistent failure in everything he attempted, as his work was completely overlooked during his lifetime. Today his works, filled with expressive color and brushwork, are regarded as indispensable and have made Van Gogh one of the most famous artists of all time. Inheriting his father's great fortune gave Gustav Cabot the freedom to paint without pressure to sell and the resources to help fund the Impressionist movement. He funded exhibitions and purchased works by fellow artists and friends, including Monet, Pissarro, and Renoir. Based on an intersection that exists to this day, Paris Street, Rainy Day, impressed critic Emile Zola, who described the figures in the foreground as representing a beautiful truth, and predicted Cabot would be revered as one of the boldest of the group. Pierre-Auguste Renoir's paintings have been described as chocolate box art, in that they are so often depictions of happy, inoffensive scenes. What did Renoir have to say about this? Why shouldn't art be pretty? There are enough unpleasant things in the world. Bold and beautiful. The building that is home to the Art Institute was originally built for the Chicago World's Fair of 1893. The Chicago World's Fair featured some notable American firsts, such as Cracker Jack, the Ferris Wheel, Juicy Fruit Gum, Quaker Oats, Cream of Wheat and Shredded Wheat, Aunt Jemima Pancake Mix, and the Hamburger. But let's not digress. Back to France, specifically 1884, with a Sunday afternoon on the island of La Grande Jatte. If you've seen the film Ferris Bueller's Day Off, you've discovered something about this painting by Georges Seurat. A closer look at a little girl reveals that there is no shape or form to her face. Motivated by studying optical and color theory, Seurat contrasted multitudes of tiny dots that form a single hue in the viewer's eye. Pointillism, he believed, would make the colors more brilliant and powerful than standard brushstrokes. On the next installment of A Visit to the Art Institute of Chicago, we go back in time as we finish our look at European art, even further back with ancient Egyptian, Greek, and Roman art, a look at the new modern wing, and more.